that's good, so I'm already studied up, and I can go home and eat good. Good, I can eat twice today, amen? So I appreciate that, amen? Want to be able to turn in our Bibles this morning, 1 Samuel chapter 13, and while you turn there, I want to be able to put this out. If we can, Brother Odell and myself, we're going to be trying to contact everybody possibly. But I really want to encourage all the aspect of leaders in First Baptist Church. So that doesn't, this is what it means. If you're in the financial committee, you're in the mission committee, you're a part of the treasury, it don't matter if you're the assistant, the wannabe assistant and all, if you're the janitor, you're the one that the junior church, the Sunday school, all of that, I want to be able to meet with you right after church next Sunday morning. We're only look to have you 10 minutes. I promise you that. I'm not gonna keep it long. I don't believe in that. God's been teaching me a lot of things. You keep it short, sweet, amen. And because everybody's got busy lives, amen. And but I want to be able to be a help to ourselves, because I really believe, folks. Listen, I really believe that God is on the urge, wanting to do something great in our church. I mean, I look back on Sunday afternoon, just a couple weekends ago, during our Easter play. And I want you to know that when I didn't pay attention to all of that, but on hindsight, I look back and seeing what God did in that day with us, and how he used us, and how he ministered to us and through us. But I want you to say, there was 128 people here. Amen. And that excites me, and it makes me nervous on one hand, but it excites me on the other hand. Amen. It makes me nervous that I don't, just don't come to my office, because I ain't gonna open the door. I mean, I just wanna stay in there, Like, man, God, I don't know, God, if it's possible to use me, then I want to be used. But you get that fear and that excitement and all of that, and I look back and I said, man, God, I know it's not me. Amen. And everything that happens, it's gotta be him. And so listen, I'm just excited that I could see right on the threshold right there to where God wants to do something. Amen. And listen, we had mistakes Sunday. We had mistakes. I mean, I don't want to tell you all the mistakes, but I sat back and for the last couple weeks, I looked at those mistakes. But God looked beyond our mistakes. Amen. And I don't know what all God did that day, but I know he stirred my heart. Amen. And you keep that encouraging. So all it does, like I said, don't matter if where you're at. If you just clean the church, you're in the nursing home ministry. You work on the website. Putting in the information on Facebook. It doesn't matter whatever you're involved into in this church as far as the ministry. I want you to. Samuel chapter 13. We're going to be looking in here the life of David. And so if you have found your place in 1 Samuel chapter 13, I would invite you for the standing and reading of the Word of God. 1 Samuel chapter 13. And as we begin to read here, I want to read verses 1 through 14 if we may. The Bible reads this. Saul reigned 1 year, and when he had reigned 2 years over Israel, Saul chose him 3,000 men of Israel, whereof 2,000 were with Saul in Michmash, and in Mount Bethel, and 1,000 were with Jonathan in Geba of Benjamin. And the rest of the people he sent every man to his tent. And Jonathan smote the garrison of the Philistines that was in Geba, and the Philistines heard of it. And Saul blew the trumpet throughout all the land, saying, let the Hebrews hear. And all Israel heard say that Saul had smitten a garrison of the Philistines, and that Israel also was had in an abomination with the Philistines. And the people were called together after Saul to Gilgal, and the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude. And they came up and pitched in Michmash, eastward from Beth-Aven, when the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, for the people were distressed. Then the people did hide themselves in caves, and in thickets, and in rocks, and in high places, and in pits. And some of the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of God and Gilgad, and Gilead. As for Saul, he was yet in Gilgal, and all the people followed him, trembling. And he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. But Samuel came not to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, "Bring hither a burnt offering to me, and peace offerings." And he offered the burnt offering. And it came to pass that as soon as he had made an end of offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to meet him, and he that he might salute him. And Samuel said, "What hast thou done?" And Saul said, "Because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together at Michmash. Therefore said I, the Philistines will come down now upon me to Gilgal, and I have not made supplication unto the Lord. I forced myself, therefore, and offered a burnt offering." And Samuel said to Saul, "Thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. But now thy kingdom shall not continue. The Lord hath sought him a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee." Let's stop our reading there and go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, dear God, in your sight. Today, dear God, we bring all our frailties, all of our strengths, and all the love that we can have, and bring it into your sight. And today, Heavenly Father, if we were to look up to heaven, we would have to ask ourselves a question: am I pleasing with you? And so today, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunities that you have given to us to honor our lives with you. And we thank you, dear God, that you bless us in such a way, Lord, that you encourage us to go beyond than what we usually go. And so today, Heavenly Father, as we look into this message, I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would set me aside. Lord, it's not in me that I would find of myself, Lord, to be able to preach a message such as this. But I pray and depend upon the Holy Spirit today to ask, dear God, that you would deliver me from any errors, Lord, that I would make that would cause a man to stumble or a woman to stumble in their faith. But I ask today, dear God, by your grace and your mercy, and I pray, dear God, by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, Lord, that you would deliver us today, Lord, from walking in a sight that's displeasing to you. And so, Heavenly Father, I ask today, dear God, that you would be with us, be with your people, and strengthen this church, dear God, that we may do your will as you have called us to do. For it's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. God bless you and be seated. May I ask you a question this morning? May I ask you a simple question? And the question would simply rely upon this. What this morning impresses God? Let's say that you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. Could it be wealth? Could it be all the possessions? What could it be? Would this please God? What if you knew and understood that the end of the beginning of your life, from the beginning to the end? Would it be intuition that you could understand or to take that and to impress God? Would it be if you were to create a star and cause the sky to thunder with lightnings? Would that strength and power in your life, would that simply impress God? What if you were able to create a rainbow or a sunset? Would your artistic talents, would that impress God? Perhaps you may have some musical ability. You're able to make the songbirds at the babbling brooks and to sing melodic tones that will bless our ears and touch our hearts. So, let me ask you a question. Really, what really impresses God? We're talking about an almighty God. We're talking about that we're unable to press Him with our wealth and possessions because He owns all the cattle. He's the most richest one that we'll ever know or understand. Would it be our intuition? When I read my Bible, I find that this God, this Almighty God, He's vast in His knowledge. He's vast in His understanding. He's vast in His wisdom. When I look at God, He's got more education than I've ever dreamed to understand somebody having. Would it be that His strength and the power in my life, or the strength and power in your life, would that be something that would impress God when in reality we're talking to Almighty God, where He's the one that has all the power and also the When my children, they go off to the library or they go off to these other subsidizing schools where my sister-in-law and my wife, they take the kids there and they take the kids and they're able to draw out the people there. They help them draw out this to bring out the artistic views. And my kids got the little homemade posters on the wall, you know, got the painted canvas and all of it, man. They're really neat looking. I mean, and I want to say to you that because of the artistic views, it shows their character, who they are, what they stand for, and all of that, amen. And so I wonder today, what kind of artistic views or creativity we can have in our life? Would that really impress God? And so no matter where we're at in our life, we need to understand that what impresses God is simply none of these abilities. Perhaps we're trying to live a life that's well-pleasing to God, and yet we don't understand that we're living a life and we don't really understand what really impresses God this morning. But I would say to you this morning, folks, that God has His eye on the affairs of man. God's not only watching in the life of the preacher, but He's also watching in the life of individuals. I believe that today, if we're going to impress God, then we're going to have to know that God is an all-powerful, all-knowing God. And yet these gifts and talents, they don't impress Him, but there is some things that does. And I would like to be able to bring that out to you this morning. So, what is it that impresses God? Well, we find in this text here, we find some questions or some answers to our question. And so, we see here King Saul. Was anointed to be the first king of Israel, and we find that it wasn't a year or two or three down the road where King Saul began to change some things. He changed the way God wanted him to do things. And so go with me back into our text to chapter 13. And so as we do our best to bring out a little history of where we're at. But here we find verse 1, Saul reigned 1 year, and when he had reigned 2 years over Israel, Saul chose him 3,000 men of Israel, whereof 2,000 were with Saul and Michmash, and in Mount Bethel, and 1,000 were with Jonathan and Gibeah, and of Benjamin, and the rest of the people he sent every man to his tent. Now, folks, I want to say to you that here we find Saul. He's arraying for battle. And now he's gathering the men together, he's preparing himself to go into this battle. And so here we see in Saul, a man of authority, a man of well enough riches that he can command the troops to do exactly what he wants to. We find in verse 2 that he sent every man to his tent. And so we find that this man was well enough in authority. And so so as they begin to prepare for battle, there's something that we didn't understand about the story of Saul. But as Saul began to prepare for battle, we find that in the story that something changed in the life of Saul. And so as we have went through our reading, and we can go back and we can trace that that reading, but then go to where verse 8, and here I believe that we can really find the change in Saul's life. So here we find, and he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. But Samuel came not to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, bring hither a burnt offering to me, and peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offerings. And it came to pass that as soon as he had made an end of the offering, the burnt offerings, behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to meet him, that he might salute him. Now, folks, we find that Saul, we talked about that there's that authority that was given him, and here he was ready to gather his men to prepare for battle. And here he's getting ready to go into battle. But here we find that in verse 8, that's the change that we can find. Now, here the people that Saul had that was under his rule, they began to get nervous. And they began to scatter. The Bible says that they hid themselves in the caves and the rocks, and they went to hide themselves. I mean, they became the cowardly. And so here we find Saul trying to bring them back together. And now we see where Saul, he moves himself from being the king, okay? He's to be the commander. And then he places himself into the authority of the priesthood. Now, some of you may say, well, that's okay. That's all right. But here, God didn't deem for Saul to be a priest. He deemed him to be the king. And so this, because of what he did, I mean, look what the Bible says. Verse 11, and Samuel said, what hast thou done? And Saul said, because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together and Michmash. Here Saul had become nervous, and he wanted to bring back the children of Israel through the works of trying to be the priest. All right? Now, so you say, what does all that really mean? Well, I want to show you that here, that's where the change that we find in the life of Saul, and it was a spiral, a going downwards. He spiraled himself into a spiritual darkness that he didn't understand. We can find that since this time, that there were other occasions where Saul, he tried to go and get the trying to think of the wicked witch or whatever, and he got the wicked witch trying to get them to where you know, get the blessings of God and all that. He did all that. He did evil surmises in his life, and he could never get the Spirit of God back into his life. Why? Because he messed it up. See, it's not like the way we serve God today. Back then, when a man served God and God wanted to use that man had to walk according to the Scriptures. And if he was in obedience to the Scriptures, then when God wanted to use the man, the Spirit of God would come upon the man. But here, where we're at in our lives, it's different because God lives in our heart. Amen. And so here we find that this this descendants of this spiritual darkness began to cause an emotional collapse, not just in the life of Saul, but in what God was trying to orchestrate in the life of his people. It began to cause not just in a spiritual darkness in Saul's life, but it began in the life of his people. So, what does all that mean? Well, I want to say to you that tonight, this morning, that since Saul made that disruption in the life, his life, and in the life of the people, God removed him from leadership. And so, let's look at that. Verse 14, go with me. Verse 13, the Bible says, and Samuel said to Saul, thou hast done foolishly, thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. So God was wanting to do something everlasting here in the life of Saul. But because what Saul did, we find that he lost out the opportunity. And so that day, Saul lost his right to rule over God's kingdom. We find that in verse 14, look what happened. Let me just prove to you how he lost his right. Verse 14, but now thy kingdom shall, Samuel's telling Saul, but now thy kingdom shall not continue, for the Lord hath sought him a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee. And Samuel rose and got him up from Gilgal and Gilgal and Benjamin, and Saul numbered the people that were present with them, about 600 men. Folks, I want to say to you that to be able to know where we're at, we need to know how we can discover the changes that brought out into Saul's life. God wanted to use Saul, and he wanted to establish his kingdom. He would have established his kingdom by Saul, but Saul, he chose to disobey, or he chose to step forth. What I'm saying to you today is this. Sometimes we're thinking that we're walking with God. In fact, we're walking ahead of God. I want to say to you today that we miss out when we misconstrue what God wants us to do. Okay? Now let me explain this to you. All right? God called me to be a pastor. He didn't call me to be a music leader. Amen? But if you depended upon me to be a music leader, I'd be running everybody out of here. Amen? Although I know what good music is. But I want to say to you tonight that here God gives us positions in our life to manage. Now, go with me to Acts chapter. Keep your book there, your hand on Saul. Alright? I'll put my marker there. And go with me to Acts chapter 13. Because in Acts chapter 13, we find that Paul made a comment about this new king. And so we want to see what David's got to say about this new king being formed. And so look at me to Acts chapter 13 and verse 22, if you may. verse 22, the Bible says in Acts chapter 13, and when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. And so this morning, here we find David. David was, as the Bible says, a man after God's own heart. And so for us to be able to consider what God is looking at into our life, we must consider ourselves this morning the type of character that David was in himself. Now, let's just stop and remember who David really was. We know how the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Amen? And so here we, before we get able to get an understanding of the message says, is this, that David was a murderer. David was an adulteress. David took another man's wife and committed sexual sins and then turned around, killed her husband, and then turned around and married this woman. And so by heart, by nature, David was a sinner. And so, but yet God began to, God still wanted to use this man, even though that he was a sinner. But look, you ever commit a murder? All right? I mean, I'm not asking, don't raise your hand, amen. I don't want to know, amen. Amen. But Jesus did say that if you hate your brother, you commit a murder. Amen. So let's look at it well. You commit adultery, don't raise your hand. Amen. But Jesus said, if you look on a woman and lust after her, you've already committed adultery. And so, folks, I'm trying to get you to understand here, David, he was a murderer, he was an adulteress, and yet the Bible says about David that he was a man after God's own heart. Now, sometimes that we go through life, we just want to scratch our heads and ponder about that. How can God call this man a murderer, an adulteress, a man after God's own heart? Now, didn't we learn in VBS that God was a holy God, and that he was a God of righteousness? So how can God use a man that has sinned in his life and a man that God deems, deems to be a man after his own heart? And so that's what I want to be able to work through today. As we begin to look into the character and the life of David, the only best way that I can know what all that really means is for me to turn my Bible to Psalms chapter 51. So when you turn your Bible to Psalms chapter 51 along with me, and here we're going to find, this is where I told you, I'm out of my comfort zone, 7 points. I'm used to preaching 3 points, amen. But if I can do what I can in 7 points, amen. What I do in 3 points is all right, amen. So let's just get with it, amen. But Psalms chapter 51 is where we want to find our text. And we're here, most of us perhaps know a little bit about this, but this morning I want to give to you what God has placed in my heart for this morning's message. Now let's just read Psalms chapter 51, and then we'll come back and we'll make the comments, and we won't be long, and we'll, before you know it, we'll go home, amen. Psalms 51, starting verse 1. Here David reads, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Deliver me from blood guiltless, O God, thou God of my salvation. My tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, and a broken and contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Do good in thy sight, good pleasure unto Sion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice, with the sacrifices of righteousness, and burnt offering and whole burnt offering. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar. And so here we want to see that as the Bible begins to proceed, we're going to find 7 points this morning. And I want to be able to just give you those points. I don't want to interrupt the Spirit of God, but I would encourage you this morning, if you would do me a favor this morning, would you take out a pen and you write these points down, and you can go back yourself and you can study what God is trying to say in the Scriptures. I believe that that this church, and as long as I'm pastor here in this church will not be a church that condemns other people. This church is going to be used as best as I can possibly lead, to be able to lead into what God wants it to be. It's going to be a church where we can love and embrace and encourage one another. I'm not for this religious pharisaical type of way that I'm better than you and you're better than me, but I want to be able to teach the Scriptures and let God do His work in your life as He used to do the work in my life. Amen. Listen, folks, we need to understand, as I already made mention, that the Bible says that we are all sinners by nature. Not one of us is better or more approachable than when we are truly at the cross of Jesus. Amen? Folks, we need to see this morning what God is trying to do in our church, because God wants to use, it doesn't matter. Listen, I will be open and honest to you. I've seen God use my very own children for His glory. And I want to say to you today, you and I, as His people, that we can understand the words of Christ today. We can understand what the Bible says, that God wants to use us. And so, let's look into these points. First of all, we're going to reread the verses, and I'll give you the point. But first of all, let's look at verses 1 through 4 once again. Here the Bible says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest." The first thing that I would encourage you to write down this morning, according to verses 1 through 4, is here David. David concerned himself with the presence of God. if God is ever going to build a character in your life and my life to use for His glory, then it's going to be a character that is concerned with His presence. The thing that we want to practice here is that we want to practice the very presence of God. You would say, Pastor, I've practiced the presence of God before, and I've never seen God move in my life. Folks, I will say to you that there is a process or a systematic that should be established into our life for us to be able to understand what the presence of God is. You have to remind yourself, I have to remind myself, that God is a God of holiness. And if you and I are going to be able to see or understand or to nurture the presence of God, then it's going to be that we must learn how ourselves know how to attain holiness in our life. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, that we are to know how to behave ourselves in the house of God. And so, what does that mean? Well, it's that we come here in a predetermined attitude that we're going to be holy-like people. Now, that doesn't mean that we are holy. But being holy is simply knowing that we claim God's righteousness in our lives, and then because of that, that's how we live our life. We live our lives by the grace that God has supplied into our life. And so David thought that his sins was hidden. Here he thought that Samuel didn't find out about my sin. I got away with it. And we find here in the scripture that here is Nathan coming on the scene, a prophet that by the hand of God comes to David and exposes his sin. We know, as Nathan mentioned before, that he took another man's wife and killed the husband and covered it up and all of that. And yet, this morning, we need to understand that no sin, whether big or small, is covered up in the eyes of God. And so this morning, I can't judge you because I have no sin to deal with. And so don't ever think that the pastor from this pulpit, or that any man of God from this pulpit, as long as I'm pastor in this church, will ever be a preacher that condemns. So what does it mean that when a preacher stands there and preaches the pulpit? So listen, folks, I don't preach what I think that I know is best. I'm going to preach what God says is best. And so I want you to understand that, because that's a lie. When we come to church, God has a message for you and I, and we are to be people that receive that. Amen? So what does that mean? Well, let's say it this way. The positions that God gives us in life are positions that should teach us the authority that God has over us. This morning, God wants you to know that He watches the affairs of your life. And because of it, we are to submit unto the presence of God. And so, David went ahead, he cried out to this God, and look at me, just a real glimpse real quick, but look what he cried out in verse 3 and 4. Psalms chapter 51, verse 3 and 4. He says, "For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me." Now, because of the presence of God, now David realizes that everywhere he goes, his sin is with him. It's right there. Amen? Here he tried to hide it before. He tried to cover it up from the presence of God, but yet God seen his sin, and God uncovered it. And now he says, everywhere I go, there's my sin. Go with me in verse 4. He said, "Against thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight." Did you get that? He didn't say, "Well, I sinned against the preacher, or I sinned against the prophet, or I sinned against the deacon, or I sinned against another man." He said, David said, "Against thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight." Listen, don't ever expect that the preacher is watching you. He's trying to be concerned about your life and all of that. Hey, I can't even keep up with all y'all. Amen? And so don't expect me to be concerned with what you're doing and don't do. And so I say all that for a reason, because, I want to be a loving, kind preacher, amen. Yes, I want to preach the Bible, but I want you to know in your heart that I love you, and I want the best for you and this church, and I've got to preach the Bible, amen. And so here we find that David said that my sin is ever before me. And so sometimes we are not in direct contact of sin, but sometimes it seems that we live under convictions. And so what does that really mean? Well, several reasons that can cause us to live under the convictions of God. Turn with me to Ephesians real quick, Ephesians chapter 4, real quick, you find this verse in your Bible, I would mark it out, I would take notes, I would underline it, I would do everything possibly I can to memorize this verse. But here, Ephesians chapter 4, God gives us some insight, some things that will cause his convictions or bring convictions into our life. Now here in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 30, here the Bible reads, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption." Aren't you glad of that today? That you're not sealed because of the pastor is the pastor of First Baptist, but you're sealed because of the Holy Spirit of God. When you got saved, you surrendered your heart to Jesus Christ, it was by his Spirit that sealed you. But look what happens. He says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God." Listen, folks, I'm not that smart enough, and I went and looked at that word grieve up, but that word grieve simply means to cause distress. To cause distress. And so today, you may not be in contact with sin, you may not be in direct contact with sin, but in some way, something in your life, you may be grieving the Holy Spirit of God. And when you're grieving the Holy Spirit of God, God's going to do his best. With a loving Heavenly Father as he is, he's going to try to get you back where you need to be. And he does that through conviction. Amen? So, you ignore the conviction. What happens then? Well, God will bring his chastisement on you. Now, I'm not saying any of us without blame sin, but I'm just saying to you this morning that in the message, God wants us to understand that we may not be in direct contact, but there's something that is causing to grieve the Spirit of God in our life, and therefore, God is trying to bring it to our attention, and we're not hearing it. We're not seeing what he's saying. The second thing that we will look goes to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Real quick, amen, because we're running out of time. And I wanted to finish this message. If I do, great. If I don't, we'll pick it up next week, amen. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, if we may. Look with me here. One verse. And the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19. Three words. Four words. Quench not the Spirit. Now here again, we're talking about the Spirit. Now you see that word Spirit is capitalized. Then that means that is dealing with the headship of God, the third person in Trinity. The capitalized Spirit of God means that there is deity there, right? And so here, the Bible gives this word quench. Quench not the Spirit of God. So what does the word quench mean? Well, the word quench simply means to extinguish. And so today there might be not some direct contact of sin, but there may be something in our life that is simply quenching the Spirit of God. It's like we talk about the quenching of the Spirit of God. It's like think about a house on fire, burning up in blaze. And what do? You call the fire department. They come there with all their little fire extinguishers. I mean, you know, you got the little, no, man. They bring the fire truck, amen? And it depends upon what needs to be put out, but sometimes they bring the fire truck and they spray the house for hours and hours. Why? Trying to quench the thirst of that fire. And maybe today, God is willing to do some great things in your life. He's willing to do some dynamic things, some things that will make him to be as we all should be in awe about God. And so, here this morning, it may not be some direct contact of sin, but something in our life is quenching grieving the Holy Spirit in our life. And so I don't know what it is. I'm not your God, amen? I mean, I'm your pastor. I can only give the message as God's direct my heart. But then, I want you to know, but by a merciful God, God wants to use us, amen?
Amen.
And therefore, we got to see the characteristics that was found in David. And so here, David was a man. As we looked into that, he was a man that he presented himself into the presence of God. Amen. I will say to you today that here in our life, we need to be folks that are concerned with the presence of God. Amen. You say, Pastor, what does all that mean? Listen, folks, I want you to know this morning that when I see, when I discovered, and I looked at it, just here recently, me and Mr. Odell got into the office. We just in there for a casual day and talking about what God is doing around here, God began to remind us that we can go back and we can show you, we can put it out on the table and show you that we keep record. Alright? We keep records, not people who come and stuff like that, but we do keep as what we find, what they did there in the Bible that they numbered. Amen? Saul numbered his men. Alright? And so we numbered that, and God is my witness, it floored me. Amen? It floored me. It's like, whoa, what's going on here? And so we get a look at the records, and we watched the records where they were 50 and their 60s, and last year we were in the 70s and the 80s, and folks, I want you to know, in this year's time, we've been breaking the 90s, amen? I mean, we've been working out in the 80s and the 90s, where last year we were in the 70s and early 80s, but here we're working in the high 80s and the 90s, and so what does that say to you? I'm saying to you that God is concerned about his presence in his church. And I believe that if you and I would get on the right page, if we can get more involved in God's presence, what God will really do, amen? Well, I wonder what how much is 128 plus 128, amen? That's like 240, 260 something, amen? 256, amen? Boy, what would it be like, amen, to have 256, 128 on this side, 128 on this side? I tell you what, I guarantee I'll be on my best behavior, amen? So what does all that mean to you? Listen, folks, listen, none of that could really happen without the presence of God. I will say to you, if we don't have the presence of God in our life, then everything we're doing is in vain. We need that. And so here David, he was a man that concerned himself with the presence of God. Well, we're not going to be able to get through that, but I'll give you the second point, and we'll go from there, and amen. I don't care if it turns out to be a Bible study or a month-long sermon. It don't really matter to me, but what I'm really concerned about, that we can reach those characteristics that David had, because David was unique in his way he did. And we know that David said, but God used him mightily. And God's still using him today. Amen. We know that David was used. He's in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Well, what would that be like? Amen. I don't know. But I believe this. If you're saved today, you're in that lineage. That's how I believe. Amen. All right. And so let me give you the second point. I don't want to tarry too long, but I will give it to you because it makes me excited. I can go, Brother Higgins said, man, hey, man, you know, if everybody will come, we just preach 3 hours, amen. So, man, how do we get to preach 3 hours? Well, I can't, amen. Whatever. I'm just kidding, amen. Second point, found in verse 5 and 6. Look at look with me. Verse 5 and 6. The Bible says, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom." May I give to you this, not only the two things here this morning, but this morning as a reminder, David concerned himself with the presence of God. Here, the second point in verses 5 and 6, we find that David cultivated himself with the precepts of God. David cultivated himself. Now, let me give you that word cultivate. Cultivate simply means to acquire or develop. So he began to develop some qualities and skills about himself. We find that David was a man of war, but also, although that David was a man of war, David was a man of compassion. Okay, and so we're not here to pick it up. Maybe I'll back up next week, bring that out a little bit more. But here this morning, I want to say to you that you and I, as God's people, we need to develop some skills. What kind of skills would do us good in our church? Well, I want to say to you that tonight, this morning, that some of the greatest struggles that I've seen that this church has is communication skills.
Amen.
And I want to say to you that you and I, we need to be on a one-on-one scale of communication. There is oftentimes that's in this church, oftentimes there are things that are happening and I never get wind of it until it's too late. And so what happens? What does that really mean? Well, really mean what that really happens is that if you never take time to go to your pastor, you never take your heart or your fellowship to the pastor, and oftentimes what really happens is that you get hurt. You get your feelings hurt. You think, "Well, pastor don't love me," or "he don't concern about me. He's too involved in this." And that's way not what the truth is. That's how the devil wants you to perceive that. And even if it was true, don't you think that I deserve enough right to know where I'm in error? Amen? And it'd be your responsibility, because you want to hold your pastor with some accountability, and you want your pastor to be a good pastor, so you would go to him and say, "Hey, Pastor Boyce, you know, I've been seeing this, and I'm kind of a little disturbed about it, and I want to sit down and talk to you about it." Would that be fair? I think it'd be fair. Just like if it was fair. If I didn't see you in church quite often, I should be in your house. Hey, why aren't you being in church? Amen? Oh, I'm not picking on you. I'm not saying, "Well, you're so gross sin. And because you're gross sin, you stay out of church." Man, ain't nothing got nothing to do with it, amen? I don't know your heart just like you don't know mine. But here, there ought to be some skills developing in our life, because there's some things God gives an opportunity that we are to cultivate. That is simply that we are to acquire. We are to develop. Amen? And so, folks, we need to develop some communicating skills. Right? You say, "Pastor, what does that mean?" Well, I'm saying to you that, listen, anybody that's above 20, let's change this. Anybody above 13, anybody above 10, do you like to have babysitters where everybody tell you what you need to do and how to do it and all of that, you know? I mean, you wouldn't like that, would you? Well, good, because I'm not going to treat you like that. Amen? And so what does that mean? Well, when I had some things, or there's some things in this church that needs to be taken care of, I should be able to call you up and say, "Hey, I need a little help. This is what we need to take care of." And your response is, "I do what I can do." And that's all is required, amen? That's communication skills. We had a men's prayer meeting just last night. You know, I didn't rip and rail on the men of the things that they're lacking in. I rip and rail on the men the things that this church is lacking in. And there's a lot of things. We got the fence to finish out there. We got to paint the, if you notice, we got to paint the place set out there. Why? Well, see, all of that is our responsibility. This is our church, and they need some communication happening because so we can take care of it. Amen? So that's all of our responsibility. So here we see that there's some skills, and not only that there's communication skills, we learn how to speak, but there's also some communication skills and listening. There ought to be some skills in listening. Well, he said, what do you mean listening? Well, there ought to be some skills that we're listening to what God is speaking to us, amen? I would say that we all need to practice on that. I need to practice on that. I need to take more time in hearing what God has written and tell me than I am trying to do all the other things around the church. And so that's why I made a determination that I'm going to back away from a few things, although I can do a lot of things, but that's not what God's called me here to do. Amen. God's called me here to be a Bible preacher, and I want to do that. And therefore, I need to delegate some of that stuff into your hands, and you communicate to me, and I communicate to you, right? And that's what we're going to do. We're listening to each other. And I believe that here, David, he cultivated these precepts about God. You know, after David realized that his sin was in the sight of God, and after he realized that he sinned against God and only God, he developed these skills, began to listen to more of what God was trying to lead him into. Amen? Listen, do understand this. God will never lead you into temptation.
Amen.
But he will always try to lead you out of temptation. So let's don't get it backwards, amen? If God is wanting to lead in our life, he's not trying to lead us to be firm in the church. He's not trying to lead us to where we're not having any communication. Hey, God desires that you and I communicate with him. And you know, Jesus gave an example of that. Every morning he communicated with his Father. You find Jesus going off early in the morning, going off before the disciples ever will come, and went off into prayer. I want to say this morning that you and I, maybe some of those things that grieve God, some of those things that quenches God in our life, not saying that we're out and we're in direct contact with sin, but maybe there's some things that how we grieve or quench the Spirit of God is that some things we're not doing. God is called to be calls to a life of holiness. God has called us to be accountable to one another. All right, this is your family. This is my family. We're to be accountable to one another. Amen. And so God has called us to some things. So oftentimes we will always make a wrong decision in our life when we leave God out. And so this morning, let's include God in our communicating skills. Amen. So we're going to stop right there. I'll pick it up next.